to the second episode of Gretchen's Garage. In this episode, I will talk about my first encounter with the very first StuKa replica ever built, the Langhurst StuKa, built by Louis Langhurst in 1979 in Mississippi. I will also included in this episode is some photographs, some slides of the construction of Gretchen's airframe. I started this project before these little things. So there's not much video in the first couple episodes because I didn't have it. There are a number of photographs that were required to be taken for an inspection to present it to the inspector when it came time to inspect the aircraft. So there are a lot of photographs, a lot of slides, and explanations attached to them. I will introduce more videos as time goes on and as work to the aircraft progresses. But for now, let's go back in time again to where I saw for the first time the airplane that really got my attention. That year I was full throttle touring in a rock band that traveled mostly the East Coast of the United States, parts of the Midwest, and Canada. My interest in hands-on aviation was limited to holding a book or magazine and reading about flying machines and the men and women who flew them. This was a unique and remarkable contribution to the world of homebuilts and the aviation community. It was the first of its kind. And I encourage you to read more about N87LL, its fascinating history and personal connection to Germany's most highly decorated pilot and the owners of that magnificent aircraft. I have the distinct pleasure and honor of having the friendship of its current owner, Mitch Sammons of Maine. Mitch has answered many questions for me and provided me with many details about his aircraft, and I am very thankful for that. Okay, it's 1980, I'm in the band, and I'm having a great time. But to continue Gretchen's story, we need to jump ahead about 20 years. So push the fast forward button on your VCR, and let's get to the 21st century. Louis Langhurst was an excellent welder, so his airframe was constructed entirely of aircraft-grade steel. I have no experience welding. His engine was larger too, a like humming aircraft engine to accommodate the extra weight. I had decided to do a conversion of an air-cooled Corvair engine, a popular, inexpensive, and durable substitute for my power plant. I also made the decision to use lighter weight aluminum for my metalwork whenever possible. That left the airframe. My initial plan was to cover it all in styrofoam and glaze it over with fiberglass and resin. But that was something that needed to be done kind of all at once with regards to buying the materials, and I needed a way to add to it a little at a time, learning as I went. That's when I decided to make it a Gretchen's StuKa. Cover the wooden airframe with thin aircraft-grade aluminum. That way it would have the look of an original, and I could work on it one sheet at a time, as money and time allowed. So I set about making a jig to do just that.
I had never built a flying model, and radio-controlled enthusiasts and builders of flying models who had seen Gretchen's construction or the construction of her airframe remarked how similar it was to building their flying models. That kind of intrigued me because it made me think that Gretchen was actually my first flying model, only on a much larger scale. For the airframe, I chose Sitka spruce sheathed in plywood. That is a building technique which makes it tried and true, something I needed to have in my repertoire as a new home-built designer slash builder. It was also very valuable advice to me by way of my EAA comrades. That is, work with what you are familiar. Even Louis Langhurst mentioned in his builder's guide that he saw no reason that the StuKa could not be made out of wood. That solved a lot of problems for me. Out of necessity, there would be plenty of experimental techniques to come, which would come in the way of the canopy section. I will talk about that in the next episode of Gretchen's Garage.
Okay, so now I had an airframe, and that was one more airframe than I had ever built before. There was only one problem. It didn't look like a StuKa, or even any airplane for that matter. This box represents Gretchen's airframe covered in plywood at that time. I don't have any video of that, and I don't have any photographs of that, but this is basically what happened at about 2 o'clock in the morning after working on her for about 12 hours. I was tired. I sat down and decided to have a beer and just kind of look at things. So I had my level in my hand and just set it on top of the frame pretty much like that. And as I looked at it, it came to me what I had to do to make this square surface round. I grabbed another level, put it on the side, and then clamped pieces of aluminum, a flat piece of aluminum to it, and there was my solution to the problem. We were coming into winter at that time, and since my garage was unheated, that meant that all woodwork gluing had to stop. I decided to work on the metalwork, which would also make it look more like the airplane that I was trying to build, because I was going to start on the canopy section. What came next was a period of almost 3 years where no work was done on the project. I moved. There was no garage at the new location, and she had to sit in storage until one was built. When it finally got built, she got a new home, one that I designed within the town codes, building codes, that was more accommodating to constructing an airplane. It wasn't a hangar, but we had a lot more space. See you in the next episode of Gretchen's Garage.
And there it goes. there was one other very important thing about this project. This building process has always been about working backwards. In other words, I always knew what the final result was supposed to look like. So I just reverse engineered everything in my head to get it to that point. In the meantime, I learned a lot along the way. I learned that every aircraft, regardless of manufacturer, is experimental until proven. I learned that structural versus non-structural was very significant with regards to cost and sometimes weight. I learned that the sum of the parts of the plane, such as a single rib or a piece of wood, can be damaged until it is made part of the aircraft. Then it becomes stronger. It's a layering process. I learned that it's not a race, that nobody should feel guilty about how fast or slow you build. And most importantly, I learned to listen to the voices of experience. They have walked and sometimes cleared the path that I was only beginning to walk.
The angles don't leave it.
Thank you.